How's it going, people? Today we're going to watch Stevie Ray Vaughan, and I'll just click play and we'll get him up there. There we go. We'll watch some Stevie Ray Vaughan doing Texas Flood. This song's actually a cover. I totally forget who did it, but I don't care, but it is a cover. And it's kind of one of his more well-known kind of guitar classics that people like to listen to. It encapsulates that Texas vibe of, you know, rattlesnakes and, you know, road signs and those road houses and cowboy boots and hats. It's just got that total vibe to it. It's live at the El Macombo, which is probably his best live performance. If you're a Stevie Ray Vaughan fan, you've seen it. Everyone's seen it. This is my favorite performance from Stevie. This is the first one I saw, and I thought, what the hell is this guy doing, man? It just blew me away. So we'll watch some Texas Flood and Stevie's absolute ability to completely destroy the guitar. And tell you what, this guy's got some finger strength, because we all know how thick his strings are, and he is bending those strings like nothing else. Let's watch it, see how we go. So we just had that opening kind of 12-bar sequence, and one of Stevie's best abilities with his improvisation is to follow where he wants that improvisation to go. There's no technical restraints. There's no mental restraints. He's able to go musically, pick the notes, follow those notes where they should go. What he just played there was just perfect. He obviously has a wide knowledge of the blues and the certain arpeggios to go to. His tone's just incredible. I don't even know what amp he's plugging into there, whether it's a Fender, or I knew around this time he had a Dumble of some sort, those silvers, I forget the name of them. It might have just been in the studio. And I think he's just chucked on the Tube Screamer for this next part. The tones change slightly, but he's just able to follow the music. His fingers just go wherever the music wants them to go.
Down. Well, it's Texas. All of the telephone lines are down. Well, I bet you to call my baby. Lord, I can't get a single sound. Mine and I'm standing out in the road.
You know, it's just got that Texas vibe to it. And that lick, that just classic blues lick that Hendrix did a lot in Red House, and I'm sure other people played it. I don't know who played it first. Doodly doo, you know. He does it so well, and he plays it so much in this song, but it never gets old. It just gets better, and that's the sign of a top-level guitarist, you know, in a different category from everyone else. You just want to keep hearing it. You don't have any complaints of him repeating the same thing. He's meant to repeat that. That's the point. And you just want it to keep happening. So, yeah. And you know what? His singing is bloody good. I know that he's not known for his singing, and especially in the early, very, very early stages of his career, before the Texas Flood album, he wasn't singing much, and then he eventually was forced to sing to keep reinventing himself to the point we have now. He was just guitarists in bands before this. But his singing is just amazing, like, it's just awesome.
Well, dark clouds are rolling. Mine and I'm standing out in the rain. Well, the water keep a rolling. To drive Paul Stevie Ray inside.
So, you know, after that first 12 bar of his solo, he's playing so melodic. A lot of those, like, earlier bends, if you know Stevie Ray Vaughan, you know exactly what he's going to play. They become memorable, and those are kind of ascending bends that he does. You just know what's coming. You've heard it before, and it's just like, it's like a melody within his solo, and then he does all that faster stuff after, and good dynamics, you know, good contrast. Playing is just so ridiculous. His knowledge of different blues licks and what to play here and there is just so good.
Thank you.
job. Crazy is, yeah, he's playing better than anyone else can play behind his back, but he actually just changed the pickup selector to the bridge pickup behind his back. So the level of thought going into what he's doing is not just playing, he's hitting the right notes, he's playing those notes for the chords that are getting changed around, but he's also switching up the pickup selector as well, which I find quite funny.
Every day.
Yeah, oh man. Yeah, tell you what. Stop around here somewhere, eh? Towards the end there, that typical Stevie Ray Vaughan, I think he plays it on a different song. I can't quite remember where it's like tremolo picking just some of those chord triads. Awesome. Just changes the dynamic towards the end. And man, after watching that, you kind of tires you out a little bit. There's so much to take in. You know, he made it his own, this song, and it's just so classic. Very animated player, you know, I always say, like, when I first saw Stevie Ray Vaughan play in this concert, the first song is Testify, actually, in the concert, and he's just strumming solos. That's what I found amazing. All his solos, he just strums them. I thought he couldn't do that. You know, I was so used to watching Clapton play before this, or Jimmy Page or Hendrix, but Steve Ray's strumming the solo, and he strums all of his riffs, even if they're single note riffs, and which shows he has a great feel for the guitar, but also the level of control by muting other strings, and sometimes he doesn't mute those other strings, and he just knows where to hit, which is all based on his feel for his guitar. And, you know, he's obviously played this guitar like 90% of the time. And, yeah, incredible playing, just unbelievable, just a complete force. So powerful, so powerful. And, sometimes you just can't believe it. And It makes sense because he had such a strong influence on the blues. You know, I was watching a documentary a little while ago, and uh, what It was just a, what was it on? I think it was a Stevie Ray Vaughan documentary on YouTube. And what you found out was after Stevie Ray Vaughan did his thing, you know, in the 90s, a lot of older blues artists started selling more albums than they ever have, started getting booked for bigger shows than they ever have. His influence on revitalizing the blues and making it cool again after the 80s, when, you know, vintage guitars, vintage sounds weren't the big thing in the 80s. Stevie Ray Vaughan came out at a time when it was very hard for blues players to do so. All the older blues players, and you didn't hear much from them during the 80s, and even some of the more modern blues players like Clapton, they were all playing with 80s sounds. They had a lot of flanger on their guitar, and they had a lot of electric drums and synthesizers in their music, and ZZ Top were using synthesizers at the time. And Stevie Ray Vaughan came out during the 80s, and no one's more vintage gear than Stevie Ray Vaughan. He was going for those old amps and those old guitars, and he was rustic as hell. He was raw, and he paved his career during a time where he should have, in theory, been doing the complete opposite. And that's just how influential Stevie Ray Vaughan was. When you're that good, it doesn't matter what the trends are at that time. You can become successful. And he brought everyone else with him. All of a sudden, Clapton was, you know, BB King and Buddy Guy, they were all back in the game. So, incredible force within the blues community. And I don't think you're going to get many like Stevie Ray Vaughan ever again. You know, it's just, people think he was an overnight success, and he wasn't. If you look at his documentaries, the dude worked ridiculously hard for years, devoted his whole life to music with no backup plan, band after band after band, and eventually he made it. And incredible guitarist. Thank you very much, people. See you on the next one. Don't be late.